Here now is Faith to Live By with Pastor Barber.
Welcome once again to Faith to Live By. I am Pastor Barber, and this is a worship opportunity for everyone young and old, coast to coast in Canada. Thanks for being in church today. It's a joy to be with you. One viewer has asked if we should be baptized in the name of Jesus or of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We'll get to that shortly on the air, but right now, the male quartet and what I believe is the greatest hymn ever written. So the questions are yours. I go to the Bible, God's holy word, to find answers. Thank you once again for the good questions we have before us today. Question number one. Will people who turn to other religions be in heaven? I must remind you that we are not trying to be politically correct here, but rather to give answers from the word of God. And Jesus said, no man can come to the Father except by me. And Acts chapter 4 verse 12 says that there is none other name under heaven given amongst men whereby we must be saved. No, people who do not trust in Jesus Christ, regardless of their past, cannot be in heaven. Jesus is the way to heaven. And now question number two. Should I be baptized obeying Matthew 28:18 or obeying Acts 2:38? Well, Matthew 28 is the great commission of our Lord Jesus Christ. He told the church to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And then on the day of Pentecost, Peter, preaching to the crowd, referred to the same baptism. Jesus said you should baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Peter referred to that same baptism and casually called it baptism in the name of Jesus. There is no conflict here. We have to use imagination to understand conflict. Sincerity, it doesn't save. Jesus saves. And now question number three. The song says, nothing you ask will be denied. Is that true? This question comes from a woman whose husband died young and left her to raise a young family all by herself. And she wonders about this business of answer to prayer. The answer, of course, is that God does not answer all prayers. And the song that says he does, and not the Bible. The Bible says in 1 John 5:14, if you ask anything according to his will, he hears you. You remember that Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane said, Father, let this cup pass from me, and God said, no. And so even Jesus' request was turned down. And God, in his wisdom, is able to say no to you and to me when we're praying not according to the will of God. Now, question number four today. Does Acts 2:38-39, the Great Commission, fulfill Matthew 28:19, the Great Commission? Well, Peter told us on the day of Pentecost that the promise of the infilling of the Holy Spirit is to all who believe, even those that are afar off. It is God's will that everybody should be filled with the Spirit and led by the Spirit and walk in the Spirit. When the gospel is preached, that is the privilege for everyone to come to Christ and receive the power of the Holy Spirit. If we don't, then we are incomplete Christians. God wants everybody to be filled with the Spirit. Thank you so much for these good questions. I trust the answers have been amazing. If you have a question you'd like me to use on the Bible as the answer, please write it out, send it to me. I'll be pleased to hear from you, and I'll get to your question on the air just as quickly as I can. And when you write, all the address you need is simply Faith to Live By, Box 426, Winnipeg, Manitoba, and the code is R3C2H6. Let's listen to the trio now. They're advising us to look to the Lamb of God.
If you from sin are longing to be free, look to the Lamb of God. He to redeem you died on Calvary. Look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God. Save you, look to the Lamb of God.
resources that Faith to Live By makes available to you are for the church to be equipped, for believers to be strengthened, and for all to be comforted in knowing that God's word is true, and that there is power, and that there is something to be said to your life today. We have available right now this book entitled A Certain Man, Two Sons, and it contains 22 television sermons on the parables, these preached by my father, Dr. H.H. Barber. I know that so many have been blessed by these sermons, both as they have been broadcast and as they have been in print. We would love to put a copy into your hand if you do not already have it. Also, even as we've been talking repeatedly over the past number of weeks about Tim Sturby's CD, Thanks to Calvary, we would also want to make this available once again for you. Thank you for your part in Faith to Live By, how very important it is for you to be watching, for you to be encouraging others, for you to be praying for us. May we count on a letter from you this week. Our mailing address is Box 426, Winnipeg, Manitoba, and the postal code R3C2H6, and you may ask for either or both of these books and CD when you write. Thank you so very much. And now my sister Sherry will come to play the beautiful hymn, How Great Thou Art, and that will be followed by Heidi singing the well-known Jesus Loves Me.
Thank you. Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves even me.
When I tell you that Jesus rose from the dead the third day, literally, physically, and personally, your immediate reaction. Do you pass it off as mass hysteria, or that he really never died, or that the ages followed imagined it, or that it was just a lie? My text is Acts chapter 1, verse 11. Angels stood by them and said, "This same Jesus taken from you into heaven shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go." That is the way the beloved physician Luke explained things. And if you take the Bible literally, you will not have any doubt. For 20 centuries, millions of Christians around the world have clung to the conviction that Jesus conquered death, defeated Satan, and became the first fruits of them that slept. Not even one of the apostles doubted that Easter was true or thought it to be a myth. Peter believed, and St. Paul believed, and John, and James, and Thomas, and Luke, and even the angels of heaven believed. Here we are in the 21st century, billions of people around the world quote the apostles' creed. Only skeptics and atheists and cultists believe anything different. Well, this is what I believe. God raised Jesus from the dead and set him in his own right hand. Jesus is the first fruits of them that slept. The alternative is that we are in our sins, according to 1 Corinthians 15. He ever lives to make intercession for us. He is able to save to the uttermost all who come unto God by him. He is building his church, and he will come again just as they saw him go away when a cloud received him out of their sight. Go with me, please, to Acts chapter 1, verse 11. And here is the scene. It is 40 days since the cross. Jesus leads his men out to the Mount of Olives, and while he speaks to them, to their amazement, his feet leave terra firma, and they watch as he ascends into the heavens, and a cloud receives him out of their sight. Dr. Luke said that Jesus' resurrection was proved, many infallible proofs. This same Jesus, the angels said, this Jesus who was born of a virgin in Bethlehem, this same Jesus who healed blind Bartimaeus and stilled the storm on the Sea of Galilee and fed the 5,000 with a boy's basket lunch, this same Jesus who died on a cross and who was laid in Joseph of Arimathea's tomb, this same Jesus, not an angel, not a program, or a church, or a charismatic preacher, this same Jesus whom you have seen go into heaven will so come in like manner as you have seen him go, visibly, personally, physically, literally. He went into heaven, a real place. In like manner he will come again, and that's worth thinking about. Physical eyes saw him depart. Physical eyes will see him return. The message for us today is that this man of Galilee, the Christ of the cross, the companion of the Emmaus Road, will come again, and we will see him just as the disciples did back then. Of course, you can say that the whole story is just somebody's fevered imagination, written years and years ago after the facts to justify a salary paid to a pontiff. You can say that if you like, You can say that the angels were mistaken, and that when a Christian dies, Christ comes for him, but Jesus will not come again personally and physically. I am intrigued by the explanations given to Peter, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16. He says that some of the people in his day referred to the story of Easter as cunningly devised fables. I should not be surprised if in your town you could find 100 or 500 people who would put their name to the suggestion that it was cunningly devised fables. The angels believed it. They did not think that it was just an emotion of insecure people who were trying to satisfy their fears. Please follow me for a moment or two. If Jesus did not die, you have to believe that hardened Roman soldiers could not recognize death. Also, if Jesus didn't die and rise again, you have to believe that Jesus' disciples were dishonest men. And you have to believe that the church is built on a foundation of deceit, and that millions of people across 20 centuries have been deceived. And you have to discount every miracle and every answer to prayer in 20 centuries. And you have to believe that Billy Graham and D.L. Moody and John Wesley and Pastor Barber are all con artists. And you have to believe that the angels didn't know what they were talking about when they said, this same Jesus shall come again in like manner as you've seen him go. The bottom line is that it would take 100 times more faith than I have for me to believe that Jesus didn't die or that he didn't rise again from the dead. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. A question, did Jesus die on the cross? Did he rise again the third day? Do you believe that? Was St. Luke deceived when he said that Christ showed himself alive by many infallible proofs? Is the Bible true? Or were the angels mistaken when they said that this same Jesus would come again in like manner as they had seen him go? If you believe that Easter is a myth, then you have to tear a chapter out of the New Testament in your copy of the Bible, and you have to agree with the philosophers of 2,000 years ago who told Peter that it was cunningly devised fables that explains Easter. Today, I call on the moderator of the United Church of Canada, and I call on the primate of the Anglican Church in Westminster, and I call on the president of the University of Manitoba and the Prime Minister of Canada, and I ask each of them, were the angels mistaken, or will Jesus come back again just as they saw him go away? There is no other alternative. Either the angels were confused and mistaken and gave us a lie, or Jesus is coming back again. I'm looking for his coming. Every day I'm longing more. I want you to know that the angels were not mistaken. I want you to know that St. Paul knew what he was talking about. I want you to know that the promise of Christ's return to receive his church, you can bank on it. My friend, it's the truth. It's God's truth. It cannot be broken. The Word of God is a living and true and faithful, and you can trust in it for time and for eternity. Jesus is coming back again. Either that or heaven is a myth and life has no meaning. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God I believe that he is the Savior that you need, and certainly he is the Savior I need. You can call on him now and receive him into your heart.
Manitoba, R3C2H6.